Hey friends, I'm here to talk to you about one of my most favorite things, well not favorite things, but my most favorite books in the whole wide world, and that is The Robe by Lloyd C. Douglas. Just to prove to you that it truly is one of my favorite things, oh my goodness, the wind. one of my favorite books is that I have read it 6 times, and I don't typically reread books because I feel like there's just way too many books in the world waiting for me to read without rereading something I already have read before. So that's a good clue to you that I really, really love this book, and I'm contemplating reading it for a 7th time in a couple of weeks when I finish my current book. So before you get started reading this, which I'm super excited that you're getting ready to do because it's just an amazing book. Did I mention that? Let me give you a little bit of context, a little bit of background information.
So when you pick up a novel, the first thing you always want to do is kind of figure out what in the world is this about. And the cover is a great place to start because it's going to give you some clues as to what's going on. So if you look closely at the picture, if you have a book that looks like mine, you'll see that there are 2 crosses here. And we know that they're crosses because you see the feet of the men nailed to the wood. So it's got to be the base of a cross. Also, you see Roman centurions gathered around, Roman soldiers. And so that's another clue that this is a Roman execution. What's going on at the bottom of the picture is that we have some kind of game going on. So most likely this is a dice game, a gambling situation. And based on what you know about the Gospels, we know that Jesus, when he was being crucified, that the Roman centurions gambled for his clothing items. And one of those clothing items would have been, you guessed it, a robe, an outer robe. And so Lloyd C. Douglas is going to write this story based on the Roman centurions at the cross. Have you ever thought about what life was like for them? What did their life change in any way after they witnessed this crucifixion of Jesus and all the magnificent things that happened during his death and how he handled that? We do have snippets in the Gospels about what the centurions said and how they reacted in some way, but have you ever thought about what life was like for them afterwards? And that's where Lloyd C. Douglas got the idea for this story. Someone, I think, wrote to him and said, you know, I wonder whatever happened to the centurions who were at the foot of the cross. And so he's going to take, the robe is going to play a central part in the story, and the execution of Jesus is going to be kind of the turning point. Somewhat, there's kind of a couple of turning points in the story, but that's what it's going to be about. So the next question is, when did it take place? So from reviewing what you know about the history of Rome, there were 3 major time periods in Roman history, not including like the earliest when there were chieftains and clans ruling, but there was a monarchy when was ruled by a king until they got rid of that and said no more kings. Then we had the Republic, which was going pretty swell until Julius Caesar marched in, crossed the Rubicon, kind of took over like a bad boy, and changed it into the Empire, which began with the rule of Augustus Caesar officially. And this takes place during the Roman Empire, or kind of at the height of the Roman Empire, during the Julio-Claudian dynasty, under the reign of Tiberius. So you probably know that Jesus was born under the reign of Augustus, but he died under the reign of Tiberius. So again, we're going to be talking about the crucifixion of Jesus. So where does this story take place? Well, you might think that it's strictly in Judea, but it's not. So this is a map of the Roman Empire during this time period. You can see it's really extensive. It's getting larger and larger all the time. All of North Africa, you go up through Egypt, and here's Judea, and you go over, this is modern day Turkey, all of Greece, of course Italy, and then up into Europe, including Spain and Gaul and other places. So it's a massive empire. And one of the interesting things that you can, as you're reading, is you kind of get a glimpse, and it helps you understand a little bit more how the Romans operated, all these different cultures and peoples that they had to control, in a sense, how they kept order, how they managed such a large period of land under their rule. So it's really interesting to see. So we're going to basically the story is going to take place in three different main places. Rome, or not just the city, but also the area. So, you know, modern day Italy. Minoa is referred to often in the story, and that is basically Roman occupied Palestine. So let's look here. We've got, this would be, you know, of course, Italy would be Rome, unless we're talking specifically about the city. Then you've got what's referred to as Minoa, if I can get it here, is going to be over here in this area of the world, Palestine. And then the third place that you're going to see is Greece, which is here. So those are the three areas that this story takes place. The main characters of the story, the protagonist of the story is Marcellus. He is a Roman tribune. And so if you remember, a Roman tribune is an official that's elected by the plebs to speak for them in the Senate. So the common man has this spokesperson in the Senate that is supposed to speak on their behalf. But, you know, how do you become a tribune? Are you one of the common men? Are you an aristocrat? Pay attention to those things. Marcellus also serves as a senior officer in the Roman army. So again, pay attention to how the tribunes were viewed, how they were viewed by people who were not tribunes, and also how did they get their positions in the empire according to this story? Was it all in the up and up? Was there some kind of favoritism? What's going on? So is it positive or negative to be a Roman tribune at this time? Second character is Demetrius. And I have a soft spot for old Demetrius. He was the Greek slave of Marcellus. And what you really want to pay attention to, they're similar in their ages, but they're also similar in their backstories. We're going to find out how Marcellus and Demetrius actually have a lot in common based on their family histories. So pay attention to how Demetrius became a slave. And also think about, like, is this a normal master-slave relationship, do you think? Do you think that many people, because Marcellus and Demetrius are very close, they're almost like brothers or best friends in certain parts of the story. So think about, do you think this would be normal in Roman society, or is it a little bit odd? Is it just a special relationship? You also have Marcellus's family are very prominent in the very first part of the story and later on as well. So you've got Marcus, Luke, and Gallio. He's the dad. He is a prominent senator. And remember, senators during the Republic, they governed, but they became less powerful during the Empire. So they were they got to speak their piece, so to speak, but they didn't really have a ton of power like they used to. And a senator definitely had to be an aristocrat, which was a landowner, in order to be senator. So Marcellus's family is very wealthy. And, you know, as far as influence and power, they have some. His mom is Cornelia Vespania, I think it's actually Vepsania Gallio. And she's a bit kind of emotionally dramatic, kind of stereotypical woman, in that she has like these dramatic mood shifts and stuff. But really think about when you see Cornelia or Lucia, who's a sister of Marcellus, think about how women, even during the Roman Empire, even wealthy women, how they lived and how, you know, did they have very much freedom? What was a daily life like for women during this time period? So Lucia is a sister, and she's a younger sister, and she has a soft, you know, when the very first of the story, we see how she has a soft spot for twin slaves that her dad has recently acquired. And she, and that kind of tells us a little bit about her situation, her precarious situation in this story. There's some drama going on from the very start that you're going to find out between her dad and for herself. And their family's kind of in a sticky situation. And so this relationship, or this love that she has for the twins, kind of shows that sticky situation. Later on in the story, you see that she develops an interest in a character that would have been kind of scandalous for a woman of wealth and prestige in Roman Empire. So watch for that and see, do you think this happened very often? Do you think that that was something that the aristocratic families had to deal with? A love relationship between someone that was a lesser class? It's interesting to think about. So the emperor during this time period, as I've mentioned, is Emperor Tiberius. And you probably know a little bit about him. He's kind of a wacky guy, but to really understand what's going on in the story, you kind of have to really revisit his family situation. So Tiberius's mom divorced his biological dad, and she remarried Octavian, who we know as Augustus Caesar, you know, Augustus Caesar, the first Roman emperor. And so he became Augustus's stepson, and that's eventually how he became emperor. When Tiberius was old enough to marry, he married Vipsania, his first wife, and he loved her very much. It was a happy marriage, but Daddy Dearest, Augustus, forced Tiberius and Vipsania to divorce so that he could have a more politically suited marriage, a better political match, I guess you could say. So he married Julia. And that's actually that's Augustus's daughter. So it has to do with securing the position of emperor, so to speak, with the family line. So Julia and Tiberius were forced to marry, and they were not happy at all. And so in the story, one of the main characters is Diana. And this is Tiberius's granddaughter through Vipsania's side. I'm pretty sure she's just a fictional granddaughter. I've never found where she's an actual person, like that Lloyd C. Douglas found her name and used her as a, but it could be. I just haven't found that information. So anyways, Diana is the granddaughter. And the reason that Tiberius shows her special attention and affection is because she's through Vipsania's side, not Julia's side. So again, it's the wife that he loved that he has special affection for her. Also, you see the relationship between Tiberius and Julia, and it's portrayed as being very negative and not at all a happy match. So Tiberius, he didn't want to rule. He was a very reluctant ruler. He was never wanting to be emperor, but it kind of just happened that way. He was actually like ruler by default because he was kind of fourth choice, but everybody else died, and so there he was. He was stuck doing it. He was older when he became emperor. He was in his 50s. That was kind of unusual to be in your 50s when you became emperor. He became really distrustful and paranoid of people. Thought that he was always going to be attacked. Someone was always looking to assassinate him, which, you know, there were lots of assassination of emperors, so it's not like he was completely crazy. He might probably had a good reason to be paranoid. So he moved everything to all of his governmental functions to the island of Capri, and he lived there kind of in isolation so that he could remove himself from the heart of Rome and not be in what he thought as imminent danger quite so much. If you read in the 12 Caesars about Tiberius, he really lived a life of moral depravity, which many emperors and prominent Romans did, but he it's sad to read about to me. And so he ruled from Capri. I don't know why that says that twice. And he died under, well, there's two different ideas about how he died. One, he died a natural death. Some say he was injured and then he had complications from that and died. Or there's also some that say that he died by being suffocated by the Praetorian Guard. That's kind of interesting. So you'll see there how Lloyd C. Douglas decides to portray his death in the story. He does die in the story, but that's because we see Caligula or Gaius, as he's referred to in the story. Caligula is his nickname, which means little boots, and that was given to him by soldiers. His dad was Germanicus, who was this famous Roman military leader, and he used to bring him down to the soldiers' camps, and he would march around like he's big stuff, And so they gave him this nickname, Caligula, Little Boots, because of that. Anyway, Caligula becomes emperor after Tiberius, and he is the crazy one. Historians think that he may have literally been insane. He did some really weird things, like he dug up Alexander the Great's armor to wear, like, out of his grave, seriously. He also, like, wanted to fight Poseidon, so he had, like, his soldiers whip the sea when he was angry. He appointed his favorite horse as consul. Some people think that he was just joking around and trying to make a statement, like, my horse can rule better than you guys. Some people think he was literally insane. So we don't know. He did a lot of crazy stuff is all we do know for sure. And one thing that we do know for sure is that while emperor worship has been alive and well, you know, with Augustus and others, it really was during the rule of Caligula that he said, hey, you need to worship me now because I'm a god. I'm all the gods in the world. And he even ordered a statue of himself to be put in the Jewish temple. So this, of course, led to riots among Jews. It was completely forbidden to have statues to worship. I mean, that's idolatry. And you definitely aren't going to put a statue of the Roman emperor in the Jewish temple where we worship God. You know, it was unheard of. It was ridiculous. So this led to rioting. He was assassinated by the Praetorian Guard. So, you know, the very people who were hired to protect him killed him. So there must be some, you know, did they know? Were they trying to protect the empire from Caligula, this crazy dude? Or what happened there? We don't know. You'll learn more. So in the story, Gaius is really, in the story of the Robe, he's really feared because he is selfish and ruthless, which is pretty much aligned with the character that we see in him from the historical record. But specifically, he is feared by Marcellus's family because he's made inappropriate advances toward Lucia. She rejects him, and she fears that because she rejected him, he's going to make life hard on her family. Marcellus's dad has said some things that have, in the Senate and openly, that have that would make Gaius mad as well. So everybody's kind of walking on eggshells around this Caligula, who also is, you know, just, you never know what he's going to do. And it's really seen throughout the story how his influence and the fear of him influences the character's actions. So the story, it, you know, you may pick up the book and think, oh my goodness, this is a big book. But really, it's a story in three parts. The very first part is basically kind of set in Rome. You see the family. You see a typical Roman household. Well, not typical, but aristocratic Roman household, how it works. All the people that take part in that. And it happens before Marcellus encounters Jesus. And the second part of the story is when he's in Manoa and when he meets Jesus, when he witnesses his crucifixion, and when they go to Jerusalem for the Passover. And then the third part of the story is after Jesus' death. How does he handle the crucifixion? They go to Greece. Why do they go to Greece? He goes back to Manoa. He goes back to Galilee and wanders around for a while. So that's the three main parts. The thing you want to look for here while reading the story is dynamic versus static characters. If you remember, a dynamic character is one who changes throughout the story, and a static character stays the same. It's going to be a good bet to think that Tiberius is a static character, but is Marcellus a static or dynamic character? Is you know, is his father a static or dynamic character? Is Lucia static or dynamic? Do they change? So be looking for that. And also, one other character that I didn't mention earlier is Justice, and he shows up in the third part of the story. He's a Jewish Christian who serves as a guide to Marcellus and as they go through Galilee. And you'll also, during that time, encounter several biblical persons, so be on the lookout for them. So that's the Robe in a nutshell. There are a lot of characters, and one tip I would give you is just to really focus on those main characters that we've mentioned. Because if there are a few other major characters, but the main characters of the story are really who you want to focus on and what is going on in their lives, especially Marcellus. He's really the protagonist. The other thing I want to tell you is that I've never had a class where I didn't have people who hated reading that said to me, "Ms. Franks, I love this story." So if you're one of those people that are reluctant readers, I want to encourage you to give this book a chance, because I've had guys that have notoriously told me every book that we've ever read, "I hate this, I hate this, I hate this," and they like The Robe because it has guy stuff in it. Girls who hate it, hate reading, like The Robe. It has girl stuff in it. There's something for everybody in this story. And if nothing else, it really helps you look at the crucifixion of Jesus in a different way. So as we, you know, enter this Easter season, it's always a great reminder to think about, you know, the reality of Jesus's crucifixion and what that meant for people who lived through it and how it impacted them and how it impacted the world. So I hope you love it as much as I do. It's a great story, and I look forward to hearing your thoughts on it.